Great. Welcome back to Ask Flutter. And hopefully some of that keynote content piqued your interest. That was very exciting to see. So if you have a question for Ask Flutter, ask your question in the live chat.
And to be honest, the keynote had so much content that we are actually going to be having a slightly shorter Ask Flutter with you all. But please do not delay in posting your questions, because we will definitely be following up with you on Twitter. So for right now, another round of questions means another guest, and I think a man who needs no introduction from the Firebase team. Puff, welcome.
Thank you there
for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. And are you saying that I'm wearing a name tag? I didn't have to wear it?
Hopefully folks can see it. But we have some questions here about Firebase.
Can I first ask a question?
Yeah.
Can you please not kick me like you did with John?
Oh. Well, I'm pretty sure you signed a waiver.
I'm pretty sure I did.
I will not. And we will definitely keep our distance over here. But first, why don't we get into some Firebase questions, because I know that there are many of them. First off, when will we get full support for Firebase on desktop, and more specifically, on Windows?
Right. So I ask you one difficult question, and you reciprocate straight away.
I can only follow with that.
That's awesome. No, it's a great question. We get this one quite regularly. Unfortunately, it doesn't mean that I have a great answer that people are going to be fully satisfied with, just so you know. But to explain a bit about Firebase on Flutter with Windows support, I sort of want to give you some idea of where we come from and where we are going. Because Firebase was very early on in when Flutter wasn't even there, just Dart. We had a library from Dart that would talk to Firebase. Back then, it was just a real-time database on authentication. And a community member implemented that. And what they did is, guess what, right? They were talking to the native wire protocol. And those are not very easy. So there was lots of code, and I had lots of interaction with the community member about how to do all the database operations. Now, the reason I'm saying that is the Firebase SDKs are not simple. They are complex pieces of product functionality. So when we were ready to actually add many more Firebase products for Flutter, we decided to take another approach. So we decided to wrap the native SDKs that we already had for Android, iOS, and web in, you know this better than I do, what's the type of plugin that can...
Federated plugin is the word.
Federated plugins. Thank you so much, John. Even I blank on words sometimes. In federated plugins, right? So that we load the native SDK and we call out from some thin layer of Dart code so that we didn't have to replicate the functionality of those SDKs in Dart, which allowed us to get the functionality to Flutter developers quickly. Okay, now the not so satisfying part. This worked great so far, but then Flutter expanded to a number of platforms that Firebase doesn't fully support yet. Mm-hmm. That's where we are today. Right. So we've been looking into this. We see lots of demand for people saying that we should rewrite everything in Dart. And while we would love to do that, it's a lot of time commitment. Right. And keep in mind, it brings us back to where we have to replicate a lot of the native functionality. So that's not the direction we are mostly looking at in the shorter term. What we are considering is for the Unity and C++ platforms, we support developer workflows on Windows in a beta. And we're considering if we can wrap those SDKs in the federated plugins that we already have. So that's something we're considering, we're looking into. No timelines yet. Honestly, we're just trying to figure it out. We're looking to get this into the hands of developers at some point, though. But no idea why. When at the moment. So we're not
wondering. Yeah. We do know that so many Flutter developers are using Firebase now in their apps, and many of them are on Windows. So just the fact that we're starting to go down that rabbit hole and figure out all the things that would be required is really great to hear.
Two of the questions I got earlier today were precisely this, so I got a chance to practice this answer. I hope it came across.
And my favorite thing about working for Firebase team is every time we have an issue, we get first-class support from you guys, and we get a quick reply, so it's really great.
We always say, right, that Flutter and Firebase are like peanut butter and jelly, so, or like Dash and Sparky.
Yeah, like Dash and Sparky.
There you go.
Should we take another question?
I think so. Ooh. Whoever sent this my way, I'll have to thank them. Our next question is there a callback for knowing when a list of items is loaded by a scroll view? Scrolling is a particular favorite of mine in the framework. Puff, do you want to take this one?
No, I don't. I've
okay,
always
then
said
I guess.
That I don't know is a great answer to any question.
Then I guess I will. If you are an experienced Flutter developer, then you may have at some point used scroll notifications. This is a widget that you wrap around a scroll view. pretty much anywhere in your subtree, as long as it is above it, that allows you to listen to your user interacting with the scroll view as they're dragging it and changing that position. But for a long time, it eluded us in this exact case. You know, how do I know when the scroll view has been initialized? Because at that point, the user isn't actually scrolling on it yet. And so it was a little while back that a contributor developed the scroll metrics notification. And this was developed separately from the scroll notification because there are many people already listening to them. And this was more specific to listening to the metrics, the content dimensions, how long it is. And so that is the type of notification that you want to listen to that will give you that initial response when the list has been loaded.
Yeah, a lot of the features like that are kind of added. They're not added at first, and then our developers give us feedback, and then people figure it out. So it's great to see that in an open source framework, things get added.
And further, there's this other additional class that more recently was added as part of Material 3, which I know we talked about a lot earlier. The app bar, it needs to know about scrolling, so it can change colors when you scroll under it. But that presented a problem in that the app bar isn't above the scroll view. It doesn't actually really know anything about the scroll view, and it shouldn't. So we have this other widget that's called the Scroll Notification Observer, which you can place anywhere in your subtree and allow other widgets that maybe wouldn't be in the right location in your tree to listen to these notifications. And that provides both scrolling and these metric notifications. So
wow, that's
definitely
some
great
really
stuff to follow
deep
up
framework
on.
Knowledge from Kate. Thank you very much. That's awesome. So we have another question here for you, Puff. So why are the code samples in firebase.flutter.dev not updated? It's kind of a tricky question.
I love tricky questions. I love old questions. So when we Firebase has worked with Flutter for a long time, right? And we built the Flutterfire libraries, as we call them. And then people were always asking, right, when will you officially support? So right, we officially did that last I/O, right? We switched. Now, just so you know, not a single byte in any of these libraries changed when we went to official support, right? We just said now it's official. The one thing that did change is that we moved all of the documentation from firebase.flutter.dev to firebase.google.com. And so, right, when the I/O keynote was done and this was announced, we turned down firebase.flutter.dev, and then we found out that we hadn't ported everything over. But there were certain pages that couldn't fit in the Firebase site, because honestly, we wrote them specifically for Flutter. So we quickly turned it back on, put deprecation notices on the top of every page, redirect you to where you need to be. And we've been trying to keep them in sync since then. Right? We clearly haven't succeeded. So we have a plan now. We're analyzing where we still have gaps between the documentation, and we're moving it over as in the coming months. So keep flagging when you find an outdated snippet, and always look at the top of the page on firebase.flutter.dev, because there's a direct link to the up-to-date documentation in the Firebase website.
Great. I'm glad we put you on the spot there with that one, like our users love to do. So
good documentation is so important, and so thank you so much.
So this is a more general Flutter question, but I think it has something to do with Firebase. So the most important feature for my app is offline support. Is Flutter a good option? So I would say, I don't know about you, Puff, but I know of the Firebase SDKs, when you use them on an iOS or Android device, it syncs offline automatically. And when you reconnect to the network, it automatically updates your writes and reads to the database. So, I mean, I think Firebase is a great option. And I think that's one of the killer features of Firebase that maybe we don't talk about enough.
You know, and guess what? It's one of the reasons why those SDKs are not as simple as you might think, right? We earlier said, I said they're much bigger than you think. If you think of something like Firestore, right, which is primarily an online database with amazing scalability. And guess what? It's completely re-implemented in the SDK also, right? So it also has to do the same thing there, right? And yeah, we just actually made huge performance improvements there, so that the indexes that you have on your server can now also be implemented in the client SDK. So that we used to say that you should use Firestore as primarily an online database that can handle short to intermediate periods of offline. Not the case anymore. You can now use it for offline for as long as you want. Still probably more logical to use a cloud-hosted database when you want to sync to the cloud. But
Yeah, and I think that's what our users really love about Firebase, is it's so quick to get started, but it's really a scalable database that you can keep using throughout the lifecycle of your app. Yeah. So it's really great.
Yeah. And it's been great here today at Flutter Forward to actually meet with a lot of developers and seeing what they're building with these tools, right?
Yeah.
It's, for me, at least one of the highlights of being in an event like this is hearing from developers about the cool use cases and learning about the regional things. I learned so much about payment processing in Africa that is very different from Europe and the US, which I know a lot more about, and the apps that people are building on top of or for these markets.
Yeah, it's been so fun to just talk to folks and see what they're building. Everyone can just whip out their phone and show you right away, mm-hmm. and it's using Flutter and Firebase and all that stuff. So
yeah,
it's really,
I love that.
Really
yeah.
been great. So we're kind of out of questions for you, Puff, but we can keep talking about Firebase. Is there anything new in the Firebase SDK that we should know about?
Well, we did a workshop here today talking about multi-factor authentication when signing in, which is becoming more and more important. But what I really liked actually doing also was in the same workshop we were talking about count queries, right? Because we often say that, well, I'm with a bunch of Google engineers. At Google, we actually often say that counting is hard, right? Because counting at scale is actually really hard. Mm-hmm. But when you come from a relational database background, right, you do select star, count star, right? And it's easy, except that the database is working really hard to do that. Then you come to a NoSQL database and counting isn't an option. Right. And now on Firestore, actually there is an integrated count feature. And we were upgrading a demo app that we built probably 2 years ago on Firestore to use that new feature and then show like the impact on the cost that you have for that,
yeah.
which was really cool to see because it's about a thousandth of the cost that it used to be. So.
And you get that for free.
Yeah, exactly.
I just noticed that another question just popped into our feed here for Firebase. So, can you take another puff?
Let's see. We'll figure it out.
This one says, why are many calls in the Flutter SDK for Firebase asynchronous, even when the corresponding calls on iOS and Android are not?
That's a really good one. I like that. By the way, some of these questions, I sort of see a lot of these on a site like Stack Overflow, where I help a lot of developers. So I've seen this one before. And There's two types of asynchronous calls that I noticed in the Flutter SDKs for Firebase. So the ones that actually I'm most familiar with is the network calls, right? Loading data from the server. And that takes time, right? Mm-hmm. That takes time in something between dozens or hundreds of milliseconds, mm-hmm. right? So there you typically want to use a future or a stream builder, right? To handle it, the asynchronous nature, to show all the states that it might go through, right? To handle those. And then there's things like initializing the app. That call is async. And I was really surprised initially when I saw that because it isn't async on Android and iOS. Because actually, it's just a call that we handle in the thread. But on a, what was the word again? Federated plugin, right?
An federated plugin.
When we go across a process boundary, it turns out that all the calls are always asynchronous. So you're staying in the same application, but you are actually calling across process boundaries. But these take like nanoseconds to complete.
Yeah.
So I see people putting something like initialize app in their main UI and then doing a future builder, which is totally okay if you want to. It doesn't really matter all that much. You can also just put an await in your main function. It will just work fine. So that's what I recommend people doing. Nothing bad happens when you put it in your UI with a future builder. It's just simpler if you do it in your main method with await.
So I guess the takeaway there is to just add an await on your initialize app call just to be safe, but it's probably fine if you don't. But it makes sense to use async for the other stuff because Dart is first class for futures and streams. It has first class support for async code. So it just would feel wrong if it wasn't async. It would just feel wrong.
No. I loved it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, it looks like we probably have time for one more question. This one looks a little bit specific, so I'm wondering if someone offstage has additional context. Puff, I signed a user in. Why is the current user null when I restart the app?
I feel like somebody might have been looking at the top questions on Stack Overflow because this is a very common one,
really?
Actually. Remember, we were just talking about asynchronous behavior, mm-hmm. right? And Firebase authentication automatically persists the user credentials when you sign in the local storage, and it restores them automatically when you restart the app. But guess what? Restoring credentials requires that we make a call to the server, for example, to see if the user was suspended, mm-hmm. right? Something like that. So that is going on while your app is already running, right? Because we don't want to block the app while that call is happening. But you can read the property current user, and guess what? If that call to the server hasn't come back yet, current user is no. Mm-hmm. So what you should do is actually use an auth state listener, as shown in that documentation that we talked about earlier, right? And then you can respond to when the state is restored, right? And then it just becomes a responsive UI like anywhere else where you use the stream builder. So, so completely expected behavior, but definitely the first time you encountered it, it might be a bit like, huh?
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, it's great to have sample code because you can kind of just see how that's written and just kind of copy paste.
My standard answer, John, on this one is if you go to the documentation on getting the current user and take the first snippet and not the second one, you get exactly what you want.
All right, great. Do we have time for any more questions, Kate?
I don't think so. I think that we have just about run out of time. So I guess all we have left to do is to say thank you so much, Puff, for joining us.
Thank you so much, Puff.
Thanks for having me.
I hope you've been enjoying the day. I hope that everyone has been enjoying the day. I certainly am going to rewatch the keynote after this.
Yeah, and there's additional content that's been released online, so go check that out.
Mm-hmm. Should be dropping any minute, so be sure to check it out. Thank you so much for joining us. Enjoy the rest of Flutter Forward.
Enjoy. Bye.